So are people understanding how to write outcomes and goals? That's becoming clear. And then you're seeing how iRecord's working, and it's at least in its how it is set up right now. Right?
If a staff person is driving them, let's say it's an individual support staff.
Yeah.
So what is to add one in for here? Okay. So we have individual supports, which means we can then add another. Sorry, I've got to look at this.
I'm going to speed up for employment. The support coordination help desk is on speed dial if you have questions about iRecord or other kinds of things.
I just selected add a service to this one.
To be clear.
That's the same plan.
Procedure code, staff mileage reimbursement, because that's the type we have. And pretty much everything else is the same as what we've been talking about. We're going to do it in the community. And the units will be, let's say, miles.
Miles, yeah.
And how many miles do we expect them to use?
40 miles.
40 miles? We're going to do that weekly? Sorry, we are going to a faster server, so this pickup is not going to be as bad, but what's the rate?
31 cents a mile.
31 cents a mile? $1 an hour, 50 cents a year. We actually didn't have any cents planned in there, and we should have. So, we're going to leave it at $1 for now. We're going to pay them very generously. And that was the entire year, correct? I believe it was. So here's our current cost, which was in dollars.
So question then. So anytime it's a self-hire or it's a service that we're not getting an outside provider, we just pay as a service.
Correct. Okay. If it's a self-hire, it'll be Easter 6.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the 31 cents per mile?
About it.
Well, how would we put that in that equation?
Well, as soon as I allow you to put a decimal point in there, you'll be able to do it.
But
I have to go change that.
Okay.
Just you'll type 31 cents.
Got it. Can you put decimal points where you pay rate?
The rate is, yes, we're going to allow a decimal point in there as opposed to being in there. But as far as units, there is no fraction of that.
You guys just became beta testers and helped
resolve this.
Still no decimal.
There are 30-minute and 15-minute increments, so if you have 40 and a half hours, you're probably going to do it by the half hour.
Lovely.
I'm sorry, I saw other hands, but I don't have my hands. It accepts, well, it really depends on which one you're uploading for agency selection forms and see the PDF and signatures. For NJISP or PCPT and the other will accept Word, Excel, PDF, and No, I didn't try 0.31. Although I don't think it will.
Because we have decimal for the rating.
Okay.
If you get to 1.35 or 1.36, we have that.
Okay. Well, let me see if I forgot that. But either way, I'll make sure you can hit a decimal point first if necessary. Yes, docx will take, it'll take the .m and all the various new versions. It'll also have with old stuff like text files or RTFs. I think it'll even take pictures right now, but I'm not quite sure. I think we're going to restrict some of them. I don't want you guys uploading movies. They're awesome. Okay. And you can see that our allocated and unallocated amounts are putting up in here correctly. If it's an FI service and the FI posts money that's actually been expended, you'll see it under the expenditures for each of these services. Also, if you need to print out the information for a provider, which usually the FI does, but in the case they request it or you want it specifically, you can check specific boxes here for each service that you want to print, or you can check the outcomes and it'll print every service under them in a viewable PDF report, which takes longer than I want it to right now, but it will take less time in the future. And that's all 5 pages of stuff we can't quite see because it's really small on the screen. There you go. This is for each of those services that we just had in there. We have a habilitation, which is in class. That's the one that you guys didn't do and I put in earlier. Here's the DVRS one that we're talking about. No expenditure. Should have the information for the transportation. This is for DVRS transportation. Then we had individual support center. Individual supports, yep. And we have where it's being provided and all that.
So that can just report where we are with the providers.
No, this is a report of what the providers expected to be expected to provide. The report of what the provider has done as of today, you'll be able to see within this initial screen over expenditures. That'll be how much up through today's date we've spent on this expenditure based on this plan.
Because they filled the surplus.
Yes. Now we do have to talk a little bit about, do you want to get into how to approve the approval process, please, on this list? Okay, so next thing is approval.
This is awesome. I could just sit and let Chuck do the rest of the presentation.
Okay, so for approvals, I'm actually going to bounce into someone else's plan because there's some important things to note on. Hey, but did they fix the ad outcome thing?
Yes.
That's why I pink screened earlier, too. All right, so we're looking at another plan. We're looking at Ray's plan right now. And something that's important for you guys to see in this plan, when I select it, is these little exclamation points. Every time you do a plan and you want to actually submit it for approval, you have to ensure that a few things have been done first. And we're kind of forcing you to by putting these marks on here, and if you try to change the status of it, you won't be able to until they actually get fixed. First thing you got to do, if you're writing a plan, you have to look at their assessment. You may think you know all of the assessment, and that's fine, you can lie to us and say you didn't look at it by clicking it. But the first thing you've got to do in here is check a box that's going to say, yes, I've looked at the assessment, and yes, it's the right information. It's up to date. They don't need a new assessment. So to get rid of that exclamation point, we'll click into assessments. We'll view one of these, which I'm going to tell it to not open entirely right now, just because I don't want to, I guess we can look at it. Sure, why not? So we saw the assessment before. It's that one that zoomed in too far. We looked at it, and now we can check this box at the bottom. It says, this assessment has been reviewed and is up to date. This is you as the support coordinator saying, yes, before I wrote this plan, I did indeed look at their assessment, and it's generally representing what their needs are and the answers that they really should have on there. And we're going to submit that. When we do, it's going to get rid of that exclamation point. It also forces us to look at the PCBT. I understand that you just wrote a PCBT. But in a year, that PCBT may still be good, but you still need to look at it before you do the new plan that comes in. Sorry, go ahead.
I'm sorry, Chuck. So after you do it and you click yes, I view the assessment, and let's say it doesn't match.
If it doesn't match, you're not going to click yes that you...
Well, no, I know that, but then what's the next step? Like if a person's needs have changed, we're not supposed to discuss the
reassessment. You would have them contact Tricia and say that they need a reassessment because their functional criteria has changed.
And you would go and enter a case note indicating such.
But then I can't get the plan approved until they have the reassessment.
That's correct, but you wouldn't want to.
But if they still need to get to the grocery store while getting reassessed, I can't have the transportation because of
the hope is that you would notice that they need a reassessment before we actually get to the plan process. So if you see it in the beginning, you may need to document that, that you can't get that plan in place yet. If it's mid-process, hopefully you found out before, but if you happen to trip across it, there is still 30 days to actually get everything completed there. You can start building the plan yourself, have all the plan written and ready to go into the system, and their services haven't stopped yet. They still have 2 months before their initial plans expire. So there's some time frame built in there for that in the case that it takes place. It's going to be the same with the tools, though. The PCPT we're going to have to plug into and view this thing. In here we can see when this PCPT was uploaded. If we have a new PCPT that we need to upload, we can check this box. It'll bring us through to go ahead and open and upload a new one. If it's good, let's go ahead and view this so we can see what happens when we've actually reviewed it. Here's a doc, you might have seen it was a docx format, and not have, but it's going to make this old version of Word cry a little bit, but then open it up. So we've got the PCPT in here. We look through it, we decide that it's good for Ray. And now we can check this other checkbox here. The PCPT has been reviewed. You may have noticed that that wasn't there on the screen until we clicked view. That's kind of on purpose to make you actually have to click it to say that you've actually looked at it. And we'll indicate that that's up to date. Thank you, if I get my mouse back. When I do that, we should lose the next triangle. Third one, an NJISP. This is the one that you filled out by hand before you actually did this. It has a signature on it from the individual. You may want to build your plan summary first to make sure everything that you put onto that plan fits in their budget, because the system will tell you if it doesn't fit in their budget. And you may need to go back to them and make some changes on that paper and have them sign a new one before you actually put it in here. But before you can actually have one approved, you must have that signed, uploaded NJISP into this system. So we'll go ahead and upload one real quick. We can see there's nothing in here. And it definitely wants me to upload one. So I will go into the ISPs. This is Ray. We'll upload Ray's ISP. What do we do today? Status. There's two statuses here that has a support coordinator you can go to if a plan's in work in progress. You can either send it to review to your supervisor, or you can send it to review to inactive. Review to inactive is that thing we talked about before. If they go into a skilled nursing facility, they move out of state, they won the lottery, and they are not going to be seeing you anymore. Any of these things that could take place that would cause the individual to potentially be inactive. It doesn't mean that when you send it to review to inactive that they're immediately gone. The state's going to review whatever notes you put into this change to make sure that this indeed happened. So we'll go to review, and we've got to type some kind of notes in. It'll squawk at me if I try to click save and didn't type any notes in. To let the supervisor know that we completed this plan and that we're ready for approval. And if you put anything kind of sketchy in there, or you expect it's going to need to go to state approval, you might want to note it here so your supervisor knows when they look at it why it's going to require a state approval. Later on, the system's going to start forcing you to do them. Right now, I don't know that they're all in there. But like we were talking about before with a buffer, it's probably going to say if you expend more than, or you allocate more than 95% of someone's budget, and you don't leave any buffer for unexpected circumstances, it's going to say it needs to go to the state. If it doesn't have an employment outcome, it's going to go to the state. You probably want to type it in here before it gets to your supervisor and gets forced to the state, why it's not going to happen. That way, they know you're aware of it as well. If you expend 90% of the budget in like the first week because you decide to do a crazy kitchen renovation or something, that's going to make it go to the state. We're going to check anything like that. So if you put it in there and you really think it's justified and you want your supervisor to send it to the state, you probably want to type it in the notes here.
Something like vehicle modifications or
Sometimes. Now, there are some that are going to be expected. We have some that we see all the time. Handrails, for instance. See a lot of handrails. If it's a $200 handrail, it's going to be on our list of things that are generally okay. If it's a $4,000 handrail, that's going to trip a flag and it's going to go to the state. I need to know why it has to be gold-plated. If you're allergic to chrome, I need to know. But that's where it's going to come in. It's basically those things that we already know, you're going to be able to approve them at your level, they're not going to go to the state. If it's a home modification, sometimes it's justified. You need a ramp at the home, and it's going to cost $6,000 of your $16,000 budget. But really, that's one of the few needs that you really need to actually have some independence. Okay, it's going to go to the state, but the state's going to say okay to it if it's actually justified.
So right now, everything's going to the state because we're still reviewing all of the plans. So that's how it's going to work for now in interim world until all the support coordination agencies are up and running and the mentoring has been to the point where, you know, we feel like it's comfortable and you guys are understanding what you need to do. What will happen is when you come back for the training, Liz mentioned that you guys will come back when we have supports program about to be up and running and you'll get the new world, that third bubble training. That's when you'll get your list of these are the things that will get pushed up to the state and you'll know exactly what those are.
So the other thing is, currently, in the current world, you're going to set it for review. It's going to go to your supervisor before it comes to the state. Even though we're saying the state's going to review all of them, still, your supervisor's going to get it first. And they get the first whack at it to have a look and see if it's actually going to fly. And they can kick it back to you and say to change things. Their options, later on in the third bubble, they'll have an approve option. Right now, they don't have an approve option. They're going to have a state review option, which is the only place they can send it. Later on, they'll have the option. They can even send it for state review on their own. If they think something's in there and they don't know if it's gonna fly. Let's say it's an iPad. Who knows if iPads are possible? I know everybody's gonna have different answers on that. But you have one that you really think's gonna go. You might send it to state approval on your own as a supervisor to have that checked out. That's basically all there is to changing this, and when I hit review here, it's going to take my notes in and make Ray off my list. So now when I go to do list, Ray should be no longer here because I did my thing. The ball's not in my court right now. It's in my supervisor's court. Next step is to take a look at the supervisor for approval, and your job's really easy on there. When stuff shows up on your do list as a supervisor, you click it, you look through it, and you change the status to whatever status it's going to be. Right now it's going to be state approval. But later on you'll have an approve option as well. Or you have a review option where it kicks it right back, sorry, revision option, where it kicks it right back to the person who wrote the plan.
I'm just like confused. I'm used to that.
All right, so Ray was just kicked off our list, and the question is, how do we find Ray now? Just because he's not on our do list doesn't mean he doesn't exist anymore. It just means we don't have anything that we have to do with him right now. He'll come up on our list again when we need to put a monthly contact in, or when we have an annual plan that actually has to take place. So it'll tell us when we have stuff to do. But for now, if we want to find Ray, we've got to go through the search function. Now, we know Ray's name, but we also know his DDDID. Which one do you want to search by? Alright, let's go by name because it's a little bit easier right now. Who remembers his last name?
R-A-J-K-O-W-S-K-O.
I'm sorry, I was on
R-A-W.
Ross. Okay. We'll go ahead and do Ray Ross. There's not many that are assigned to this agency, so it should find him pretty easily. And there's Ray Ross. We want to see what's going on with Ray. Right now we can see basic information on him. We'll go ahead and have a look at him. See his status of this plan, which is plan version 1, is in review process. It's not in our hands right now as a support coordinator, it's in our boss's hands. We can have a look at pretty much anything we want for Ray. We can have a look at the documents that were in there. We want to see, let's just have a look at all the documents for Ray. Those are all the documents that have ever been updated. We can sort these lists if we want. We can also enter notes. Let's say Ray calls in after we go into review. We can still enter notes on him. We go into the notes section, we can see all of the notes that are there. We can filter by types if we wanted. We can look at all the notes. This will give us kind of a chronological order of what's happening with Ray in our notes system. Here's a helpful hint for those of you who are starting out with this. With real people in the system, we defaulted it to the 1st of June for what it's looking for notes in IREC. There's probably no notes except for the ones that you guys are going to enter. If you change that start date to something in the past, if they've been in DDD's system for a while, you'll be able to see the notes that were entered by DDD staff workers and kind of get an idea of what's been happening with them. We kind of put that start date in there on purpose so that you guys basically are going to see your own notes only to begin with, unless you actually go looking for notes that are further back. That's to keep things clean as it is now because we didn't have time to scrub all the notes that were in there. We can look at individual notes or we can sort by types here pretty easily. So if I just wanted to see any plan notes that have taken place, I will click plan notes and I will filter. And it'll only give me things that are plan notes.
I'm just kind of getting an idea. Probably not a good question, but for people that were moving over from self-determination, and we have lots of stuff in our files, but obviously nothing else here.
They're not going into the IREC.
So I don't need to be worried about that.
The other day, these are not IREC people.
Yep.
This is not a question that Kirk's exists.
Not yet.
Okay.
Not yet.
But not yet, but someday it may be. Right.
Someday down the road, but that's not
okay.
For today.
Okay, so it's just going
that's
into the
IREC. That's why we got training the other day, yes.
Okay.
Yep, this is for new people right now. In the future, you'll have people coming in who have been from all different places once we start getting the supports program. That's when you're going to see your rollout. People from the eRecord are going to start coming to iRecord, and you'll have more pertinence on searching for notes. We can also enter notes on this screen. If I want to enter a note today that someone's calling me, go ahead and pick today's date. What is this, 27th? Yes, it's Friday. Category, what happened? Okay, so I have a lot of options for categories here. One of them is telephone calls, and it happens to be the one that I highlighted there. It says TIIR, telephone call, or something along those lines. If we end up needing more categories for these, we'll add more categories. But these are the ones that we have in the system right now.
Yes. If say they called us yesterday, and we're documenting it today, can we just call those based through previous dates?
We can change.
We have to make a note today and just state on the note that we spoke to the things for.
I'm going
to
put this note right here on the 26th. I'm telling it when the call actually happened.
Okay.
When it saves it in the system, it's going to save the date that you're saying that you took the note and the date that you're entering it in the system as two separate things.
Okay.
So we'll be able to see when you're saying it was versus the date that it was entered. So yes, you can backdate when they were. It'll show both. So it's not going to be a surprise to anybody that we know what date you actually put it in the system and what date you said you took. So let's say it happened yesterday. I talked to him yesterday, and what did we say? Say, Saul and said, first, DDRS will be great success. Additional job training. So Ray just called. He said his first DVRS was a great success. He expects to be working towards employment soon and will be needing additional job training. He would like to meet to discuss changes to his plan. Done. I'm going to go ahead and submit it. I'm Hannah Jackson, and it is going to show up when I clear these filters. This is the most recent one. It's your phone call by me today. You can see the date on the left-hand side. This is the date I said I received the call on the 26th. We can see the date that I entered it on is today. And we can go ahead and view the note for that specific one. The information. Other things you'll be able to do with this, I believe, unless I'm mistaken, we can sort by each of these columns if we want to as well for ease of finding stuff. If you want to see history for a specific time period, if you're looking for a specific time, you can sort by that. If you're looking for when they expected that it was put in, sort by that, sort by people who have done it, pretty much anything on here.
Hello?
Any questions on notes or viewing people
can you
who are no
one
longer
second
on
for
your
me, please.
Nice. And we can, of course, search for anybody else who's assigned to this agency, but if they're not assigned to the agency, we can't get at them. Yeah, I guess I can back out. What's your next step?
A lot of it we covered, but I'll just go through the PowerPoint stuff. I mean, I think that...
We could go to the supervisor if you want as well.
So just so you know, Chuck is doing sort of tutorial videos on all of the stuff related to iRecord, so that stuff will be available within the next few weeks or so that you'll actually see hands-on him working through it and giving tutorials on it in short little vignettes. Thank you, Chuck. and that's not easy to type and talk and do all that at the same time, so you know, he should probably get canned or something. So there will be a tutorial video, and we'll probably have additional training on iRecord as we move forward. So back to the PowerPoint. So we've talked about rating goals. Selection of approved providers. We talked about this a lot already, how that's going to work. Again, you're not selecting the providers. You're talking to the family, the individual, about the options, and then they're going to be making the choices. So you'll assist in matching them to the provider that they need, helping them identify the criteria that they may be looking for and help narrow down the list with them. And then contact the potential service provider to maybe set up a meeting with them or have a conversation so that they can get to know the individual a little bit. And you'll also talk to them about whether they have availability of services or not. So you'll want to have a conversation with them about whether they're filled to capacity, if they can take on some new individuals into their services or not. Once the individual identifies the provider of choice based on their need, you'll contact the potential provider to assess availability and document the provider in the New Jersey ISP. You'll provide contact information to the provider and facilitate an introduction if you haven't already done that, if they haven't gone and done the tours and stuff like that. We're going to be saying that the provider needs to make contact with the individual to confirm that they're available to do the service within 5 working days of when they've been initially contacted. So that will help with some of that confusion that you were talking about before. And that will be in the policy manual when that comes out, so they'll know that already. But that's going to be a big part of it. If they're not getting back to them in 5 working days, then we're going to say, you know what, they must not be available to do the service, and we'll be have to pick another provider. You can change the provider selection in the ISP as necessary. And then you'll follow the authorization process, which Chuck went into a little bit, and we have some slides on that too. He talked about self-hires. I think he did a good job with that too. So a self-hire is an individual's employee. The fiscal intermediary plays the role of the employer of record in the system as it is today. So they'll get the information about that from Easter Seals in terms of the application packet and how that works. The packet will be sent to Easter Seals once that's completed. They'll review to make sure that the individual meets the qualifications that they have to meet to do that particular service. They can be an individual. They've identified the packet to become employed is through Easter Seals. And we're working on getting the packets so that you guys have access to them. So the individual or family will hire that individual. They will provide orientation and training for that individual staff member. They'll also, I think, they go through training with the Easter Seals that Easter Seals requires too. Yes, no?
Yes.
And then the fiscal intermediary also ensures that they're getting any mandatory trainings that they have to have. The individual and the family have to track their hours on a timesheet currently, and then they'll report any concerns that they may have to you as the support coordinator, which you'll work with the fiscal intermediary and or DDD to help resolve.
Make sure we don't put this service in self-hire until that self-hire has been approved for Easter Seals.
Yes. How long does it take?
Thank you.
have to be fingerprinted.
They have to be fingerprinted, so it can take some time.
It takes the staff to complete the application and get the testing done. The longest piece is the fingerprinting, because sometimes the appointments will be 3 weeks out, 4 weeks out. But for the most part, as soon as the application's done, it takes a couple of hours to get it.
So Easter Seals is so far behind right now, you could wait up to 2 months.
Yes, yeah, I've waited a lot longer.
Usually when Chuck walks toward the front of the room with his hand in the air, I need to say something.
I have an important note because I'm thinking of where this is going next. The amount of time that it takes for a self-hire, yes, it takes a good amount of time for them to get in there. And that would probably concern you because you have 30 days to complete a plan. Under those circumstances, since I knew that was where this was going, it's important to know that if you have something that's going to take a long period of time, it's known, they're going to work towards it, that's fine. That service doesn't have to be in the plan in order for it to be completed. Complete the other services, all of those that are going to go through, they can begin the plan within 30 days. If it takes a longer period, you can revise that as soon as that self-hire has gotten up to speed and can do it. Clearly, they have a need for it, but the need is being met right now. If it's something that they can wait 2 weeks for a service provider to get through that process, then that start date can be at the revision time. Does that make sense? Yes. Most assuredly.
Really?
Because you're receiving a service, supports coordination. And that supports coordination service is completed by a complete plan.
Now, I would say that if that continues over time, we would wonder why they would want to be getting DVD services at all and whether they're eligible for DVD. But.
You want to have notations because if it comes in with zero DVD services, that's not going to be something that you can approve as the support coordination supervisor. It's going to the state. So if you try to juke the system to avoid your missing your 30-day time period, we're going to see it every time you try. So that's only if you have a valid reason.
I would never think of that. You guys got the devious alarm on.
You have to. We're building a system here that's going to do stuff for us. And
wow.
We automate it. Has to pick it up. So, hopefully that's helpful. You can actually have these plans done if you're having a piece of it missing due to a long time period of getting the individual support in place if it's a self-hire.
So one of the handouts that was included in the packets of things you took this morning were operating principles and guidelines related to the individualized service plan. I'm not going to go through all of them because that would take a long time, but we want to make sure you're aware of what they are. A lot of them are kind of philosophical in nature and just general principles related to the individualized service plan. So you have that as a handout. That will be in the supports program policy manual also. So that'll be available to you that way when we get that out too. And some additional requirements that you should keep in mind, and we've talked about some of these already too. We've talked about this quite a bit, that it has to be completed within those 30 days from the individual assignment to the support coordination agency. That it's completed at least annually, meaning 365 days, to review the current plan and develop a new annual ISP that needs to be done annually. It can be modified whenever needs to be modified whenever there's a change in the individual status. And it will be distributed to all of the providers that have been identified in there as service providers, along with the person center planning tool if the person has said that they want that person center planning tool to go to that particular provider.
How is that distributed? From DVD?
From you guys.
Oh, okay. So we have
the support coordinator distributes that to the providers.
And is there nothing automatic?
Not now.
Okay.
This is current world stuff. This is middle bubble in Liz's bubbles. I'm sure she's loving that I'm referring to Liz's bubbles right now. So referral and placement, there are several different types of providers that we're looking at. Contracted providers, if someone's going into a service, that provider has a contract with the Division of Developmental Disability, they have to still be referred currently through the region in order to do that. So there are people right now who came out of the school system in 2013 in June, they're in a contracted day service provider, and some of them don't even have support coordinators yet because they haven't given us the support coordination agency selection form. Those are pretty easy plans to write, quite frankly, because they've already been identified with the services they're going to be taking, the referral's already been made to that service. But the divisional, the region, the adult and day service people will be making the packet and sending that out to the provider. For people that are self-directing their services, Easter Seals sends the welcome packet to the provider. I know that there have been questions about that from the support coordinators that have already started doing that service. The way it works is once the approval is done, Easter Seals sends the packet of information about the individual to the service provider. If they're requesting family support services, you need to get in touch with Tricia.
I'm more of the triage piece. You'll come to me and I'll figure out which who you'll be going to next.
So then she'll walk you through the process. The support coordinator sends a copy of the individualized service plan and relevant consented to discovery tools, evaluations, assessments, etc. to the provider. So again, the relevant consented to is important, but the ISP would go to all the providers and that would be sent by you. We talked about authorizing the services. That's done by the support coordinator, coordinating supervisor. In current world, it's always also done by DVD, but that'll change in the future world. So currently, all plans are being reviewed by DVD and approved by DVD. And you'll see in the future that'll change. You'll get your approval list, so you'll know exactly what's going to come to DVD all the time. Chuck went over all this stuff. You made my job easier today. So the supervisor will review the ISP, then it'll be sent to DDD in the current world. And we're looking for them to say whether they're approving it or not, just because that's part of the mentoring process too, is to really help them understand, you know, oh wait, this one shouldn't have been approved and here's why. But even though we're technically still approving all the plans. This is what happens in iRecord, and Chuck went through that already. So for the future, addressing changes in need, we've talked a little bit about this too. You're gonna wanna maintain a budgetary cushion within the services that are being allocated and the funding that's being allocated for a couple of reasons. One is for those situations where something comes up that you didn't know was going to come up, and let's face it, that always happens. There's always those unforeseen expenditures in life. We wanna make sure that we have a cushion in place to deal with that. Another example of that is for supported employment in particular, and I think that oftentimes support coordinators don't recognize this. The way the system works is someone may be getting their pre-placement services in supported employment, which is helping them find a job, and their intensive job coaching services, which is when they first get the job, helping them learn how to do the job, setting up supports, and you're on the job site, the job coach is there with them almost the whole time. That is normally paid through DVR. For the majority of people in our system. Once they go into follow-along, which is they're pretty independent on the job site, you're just needing to go in there on a monthly basis and check in to see how things are going. If things are going bad, you do a little bit more services and supports that month. If things are fine, you might do a little less in terms of services and supports that month. DDD pays for that service. So you need to make sure that if they're starting out with DVR funding for supported employment, you're gonna keep that funding cushion so that you know when that moves over to DVD funding that the funding is there to pay for that. What we're finding is happening now is that money's not being saved, that the budget's been allocated completely for a lot of people, and then they're gonna go into follow along and get that paid through for DVD, but guess what, there's no money left to do that. And then DVR is ending up paying for it, and DVR has very limited money in that system for state funding with long-term follow along. And it's not enough to cover everybody in that way. So I see Crystal, I'll get to you in a minute. And that money's supposed to be used when there's no other kind of funding that could be available for that person for long-term follow-along. So we really need to be paying the long-term follow-along for people in supported employment, and that's key. And DVR is not gonna, I don't know if they'll continue to keep on making this exception and paying for people that are supposed to be getting paid through DVD, just because the budget's been allocated in a way that didn't account for that difference in funding. So you need to keep that in mind with supported employment in particular. Something I'll go over in the employment webinar, of course. Yes, Crystal.
Sorry, my burning question was, how much do you allow? I mean, I think there's a usual allotment that you guys know through DVD in terms of follow-up. What's it cost?
It costs different, I mean, there isn't a usual
amount. I'm just saying how much, you know, I'm just saying maybe that's something that we can think about think about, because you're right, this is something we might not think of, and I'd like to be able to think, well, that'll be 3,000 in that, because that's an average cost.
We can certainly look at that. I think it's difficult because, A, not a lot of people are using supported employment funding yet, right now, unfortunately. So I don't know if there's enough numbers to really justify what the actual cost is and give a good number. And I think that as we move more into employment first and have more people, they may use more hours and follow along because we're going to allow that in a way that we haven't before. So I hesitate to give a number, but I will eventually. We can look at it.
Put it on my wish list. Just
sure.
To know, because I think that's a really good point, and that is something I absolutely would have missed if I had come to that.
Yeah, we can look at that.
Many things, I'm sure, but you know, I wouldn't think of that.
We can. Oh yeah, that's definitely something we can look at, and I will put it on my list.
Thank you.
Do I have a crystal specific list?
Of course you do.
Reassessment. We've talked about this too. If it has looked like the individual's needs have really changed and what their levels were based on the assessment that they got aren't actually accurate anymore, then they need to let us know that. Their family needs to let us know that so we can see if they need to be reassessed. Again, you don't write the letter to say that. You don't get involved in that budget process, but you would direct them to Tricia and then we would help them through that process. Just said three bullets really quickly there. Some friendly reminders, just in general, and then we're going to show a video. So friendly reminders, use your person-first language. We're expecting you to learn and use it and become very familiar with it. Support coordination is case management, as Liz talked a lot about yesterday. You want to make sure you are established and maintaining records. It's very critical to do that. I think that in the former training that was said that you wouldn't be maintaining records, but you really should. Obviously, when iRecord's up and running, that will help with that process. And that you need to distinguish between care management and advocacy, also talked about yesterday. Here's a summary of the current support coordination documents. All of these are up on that website that's run through the Box Center, so you have access to all of them. And we've delineated which ones, at least on here, we've delineated which ones are required documents and which ones are optional. Here are some resources again. So the support coordination resource page is that page we keep referring to that the Box Center runs. The help desk, again, if you have questions, please don't bombard me with questions on this. We really want to make sure they go through the help desk for several reasons. One is that then you can get consistent answers, but also we keep track of that and we'll recognize, oh, we're getting a lot of questions on this. Maybe we need to do a webinar. Maybe we need to do additional training in this area. Or maybe we'll create a frequently asked questions guide that has a lot of the questions that we've been getting on there. And New Jersey Resources, that's the book, the guide we handed out yesterday. But that's the website. You can actually download that too and provide families with that information. It's on the website, so that's why we included that there too. Technical assistance, again, the support coordination help desk. I think everybody knows Tricia, but Tricia Brennan is a great resource and help for everybody. She's been probably in contact with most of you or your supervisors at some point, especially those of you who are already doing support coordination, and will continue doing that. And she's working very closely with Jessica, so Jessica might be in touch with you guys too. Each regional office has an identified point person that's acting as a mentor, and most of them, I guess, had to leave because they have jobs that they have to do. But they were the people that were up against the wall over there that you were talking to or interacting with earlier. Again, we'll be reviewing 100% of the individualized service plans for this period of time just to make sure that we're providing you with mentorship and help and making sure that the plans get written in a way that they need to be written, because so much is going to be relying on the success of those plans and how they're written. Make sure that you use the support coordination monitoring tool and that's, again, available on that webpage. If you have questions about conflict-free, Carrie Conger is the person to contact about that. And she actually left some of her business cards over on the side, and she brought some more of mine. So if you didn't get one of mine and you want one of mine, they're over there too. And as soon as we're ready for the video, I'm gonna direct you to the back. And this is just sort of a video. Some of you may have seen it. It's called A Credo for Support. And there are going to be things, I think it's one of those things that it really is based on your own values and your own thoughts and working with people with disabilities, but this is a credo for support that was developed by people with disabilities in how they want to be treated and supported. There are going to be things that they say that you're going to agree with completely. There are going to be things that they say that you're going to say, what? I don't think I agree with that. But I think it's a really good video, and then we'll talk about it after it's shown.
Sorry, folks, give me a few seconds to find out what's going on with the sound. This could be loud. Or it could be broken.
If I ever write a memoir for myself, I'm calling it Technical Difficulties.
Throughout history, people with physical and mental disabilities have been abandoned at birth, banished from society, used as court jesters, drowned and burned during the Inquisition, gassed in Nazi Germany, and still continue to be segregated, institutionalized, tortured in the name of behavior management, abused, raped, euthanized, and murdered. Now, for the first time, people with disabilities are taking their rightful place as fully contributing citizens. The danger is that we will respond with remediation and benevolence rather than equity and respect. And so, we offer you a credo for support.
Do not see my disability as the problem. Recognize that my disability is an attribute.
Do not see my disability as a deficit. It is you who see me as deviant and helpless.
Do not try to fix me because I am not broken. Support me. I commit my own kind of duty to the community in my own way.
Do not see me in your way. I am your fellow citizen.
Do not try to modify my behavior. Be still and listen. What you define as inappropriate may be my attempt to communicate with you in the only way that I can.
Do not try to change me. You have no right. Help me know what I want to know.
Do not hide your uncertainty behind professional assistance. Be a person who listens and does not take away my struggle from me by trying to make it all better.
Do not use stories and strategies on me. Be with me, and when we struggle with each other, let that give rise to self-reflection.
Do not try to control me. I have a right to my power as a person. What you call non-compliance or manipulation may actually be the only way I can exert to control over my life.
Do not teach me to be obedient, submissive, and polite. I need to feel entitled to say no if I am to protect myself.
Do not be charitable towards me. The last thing the world needs is another Jerry Lewis. be my ally against those who exploit me for their own gratification.
Do not try to be my friend. Get to know me. We may become friends.
Do not help me, even if it makes you feel good. Ask me if I need your help. Let me show you how you can best assist me.
Do not admire me. A desire to live a full life does not warrant adoration. Respect me, for respect presumes equity.
Do not tell correctly. Listen. Support and follow.
Do not work on me. Work with me.
Do not work on me. Work with me.
Do not work.
This video is dedicated to the memory of Tracy Latimer. Written and produced by Norman Kuntz and Emma Vanderclift. Introduction spoken by Emma Vanderclift. Statements spoken by People First of San Luis Obispo.
Thoughts on the video? Anything you completely agreed with? A favorite one? You're all speechless? All of them, some people are saying all of it. I heard some, when the Jerry Lewis thing came up. Nothing? I've silenced you completely?
I've seen it several times, but I think it always packs a punch. I think it's one of those things that, you know, it doesn't matter how many times you see it, it really does pack a punch. Because no matter what, it's so easy to fall back in any one of those things.
Yeah, it's one of my favorite videos. I recently discovered this version with people with disabilities actually saying the credo themselves, which I think is awesome. And I think the more you watch it, the more you see different things in it, and you may agree with parts of it at certain times in your own life and think other things at other times. I think for me, some of the more impactful ones are just talking about don't work on me, work with me. And I love that they repeat that one over and over again. And the whole, don't admire me, living my life is not something that should be, admired. I just want to be respected. Anything people thought, why would they say that? I disagree completely. Okay. It's on YouTube. If you look up Credo for support, it'll come up. Okay, now that I'm completely... Uh-huh. It's interesting. I wonder if seeing people with disabilities saying it makes it more of that reaction. Previously, when I've shown it, it hasn't been that version, and there have been things that people think, why would they say that? That doesn't make any sense. So I think maybe having it come from directly from people with disabilities is making that a little more impactful, which is interesting. Are there any other questions about anything we've talked about in the past 2 days?
Rights and responsibilities document. Like currently when we're going and bringing scats, we're bringing 2 copies and having them signed. Then sign one, us sign one, so that the family has a copy, the DVD staff at the meeting has a copy, and we have copies. So actually we're signing like 3 copies.
Okay.
Can we do that with the rights and responsibility?
As long as there's at least 1 copy that's been signed, you can do whatever you want in terms of more copies.
Sure.
Other questions? So I have evals. I'm going to pass out the evaluations. If you can take some time to fill them out, then they really do help us make sure that we're hitting everything we need to hit in these trainings and make improvements as we go along. So your feedback is greatly appreciated. Once you fill out the evaluation, if you can leave it on this table up here, you're free to go. Thank you guys for all of your participation over the past 2 days. It's been good.